who's just here because they saw my name on the schedule? All right. So for those who are not core developers, I'll give you fair warning. In the tradition of open source, you're going to get to see the sausages made. So don't let this scare you too much, particularly the clients of mine who are in the room. All right. Anyone not know who I am? Okay. Larry Garfield, Crell, and so forth. Enough about me. First disclaimer, I've got a lot of external references in this talk. I'm going to explain them and what their relevance is. But I've also put links to all of them on the project page on the conference website, or on the session page on the conference website. And the slides will be posted afterwards, so all the links will be in there too. So you don't need to rush to find links I'm describing. That list is there now if you want it. So we're talking about managing complexity, specifically managing complexity in Drupal core. So let's start off with what do we mean by complexity? What does complexity mean? The definitions we're going to use come from a man named Rich Hickley, who's the author of the Closure Language, and a presentation he gave called Simple Made Easy. It's an hour-long presentation. I strongly recommend you all watch it and watch the sequel, which is from our own Sam Boyer at DrupalCon Austin, called Stomp Complexity. Hickley's version of this talks mostly about language design. Sam's takes the same concepts and applies it to Drupal architecture. I'm going to be applying it to Drupal, the project. So basic concept, simple. What does it mean to say that something is simple? Something is simple, the word itself comes from simplex, which is, I think, Latin, meaning one braid, one concept, one thing. It's not intertwined with something. It's just one braid. The opposite is complex. Easy, on the other hand, comes from the Latin "ius," which means to lie near. And its opposite is hard. Important thing to note, these are not even remotely related to each other. If you try and use simple and easy as synonyms, that's not actually what we're talking about. Simple means few concepts, means one concept. Easy means lying near. Lying near as in near at hand. I can easily reach for it. And Sam's giggling at me over here. Sorry. So these are very different things that we often colloquially confuse. And we need to unconfuse that. We need to separate these definitions. Another important difference between these two is that simple is objective. I can look at something, and you can look at something. You can both say there's one thing here. There's one thing going on. There's one concept. Or there are three concepts tied into each other here, which is different than something is easy, something is familiar. What's familiar to me and what's familiar to you may be completely different things. I find presenting easy. Lots of people find it incredibly hard. I find CSS ridiculously hard. John Albin breathes that stuff, and God bless him. But that's a very subjective measure. Easy and hard are very subjective, whereas simple and complex is an objective measure with a clear definition. Simple is effectively a synonym of decoupled. It's simple means there's one thing and it is not tied up with something else. That's the same concept as decoupled. Easy is familiar. Is it familiar to me? Is it familiar to a given person? Is it recognizable? But is it recognizable to whom? Simple implies learnable. Simple things can be learned because the concepts you can take one at a time. Easy simply means I can recognize it, it's familiar, I've seen this before. Does not mean that the thing I'm talking about is simple. If you already know how to play the violin, learning to play the cello is easy. It's the same basic mechanics, just a bigger size. If you're coming from writing code to playing the cello, I've done both. It's very hard to jump from writing code to playing the cello. A couple more definitions. Complex. This is a fun word. It means to make complex, as in braid together, to take two things that are separate and wire them into each other and connect them and tie them in against each other. To decomplect, I don't know if this is actually a word, but Hickey uses it, so I'm going to, is to unbraid it. It's the opposite. Pull things apart. Take the various concerns, various concepts, and pull them apart. Decouple them. That's decomplect. To compose is simply to put them together. Hence, composer, the PHP system. Not to mix them together, but to place them together. You put, you know, a variety of songs on a CD together. You're not overlapping them. You're not mixing them. You're just putting them together in a collection. They're not affecting each other. That's composing. And this concept of simple meaning one thing or one thing at a time is not new. Simplicity is a prerequisite for reliability, from Edgar Dijkstra, who is one of the founders of computer science as a discipline, who died a long time ago, which means this quote is, I don't actually have a date for it, but it's a very old one. Even older, simplicity is the ultimate sophistication, from Leonardo da Vinci. So something is sophisticated if it is simple, not if it does a lot, not if it has a lot going on, but if all of the pieces of it are nice and organized and separate from each other, if they are simple, if they are simplex. Programming, what we do, when stripped of the irrelevant mumbo jumbo, boils down to avoiding complexity, to making things simple, through vigorous separation of concerns. That is programming. That is breaking things down to individual pieces that you can solve separately and avoiding complexity, avoiding complecting. That is programming. That is software design. One problem. We as humans are very good at making complexity and very bad at understanding it. We cannot understand things that are complex, but it's really easy for us to make it. And when you build something on something else, you inherit its complexity. You can't undo something's complexity by putting stuff on top of it. Complexity is only additive. You can abstract away, you know, paper over complexity. You can make that complexity look easy. But making complexity look easy does not mean the complexity is not there. It just means you've papered over the complexity. It's a different thing. When you get right down to it, the only way to manage complexity is eliminate it. So for those asking, you know, who came here looking for a way to deal with their complexity, my answer is get rid of it, because you can't. You can only eliminate it. So how about scale? What is scale in computer science? Norris numbers. This is a fairly new concept that's starting to come around informally. And this link is to an article by Lawrence Kesseltut, who is referencing John Cook, who was talking about a conversation he had with someone named Cliff Norris. These are all big computer science name people. And the basic idea is this. Under around 2,000 lines of code, any idiot can write it. You don't need to bother with architecture. You can solve the problem by just throwing code at it until it works. And it's small enough that you can fit the whole thing in your brain at once, your typical sized human brain. And you can get it done. You know, unit testing is probably not worth the effort. And, you know, separating things out, you know, you can, but you can get by without doing so. Once you get above 2,000 lines of code, you start needing classes, packages. You need to have some kind of separation of concerns. You need structure imposed on your thinking so that you can keep up with it. You need that divide and conquer concept to be able to deal with it, to be able to reason about it. Above 20,000 lines, you know, around there or so, you start needing to look at a much more vigorous approach. You need to take a much more draconian approach to simplicity. Your approach to the problem changes when the scale changes. Down here, throw any bunch of functions at it and you're done. In here, you start needing to organize your code to keep, be able to keep up with it. You know, coming up here, you need to be rigorous and strict on how you're separating things. You need discrete packages. You have to have unit testing. You have to do things like dependency injection. Otherwise, your code becomes unmanageable and impossible to reason about. And this article said, I'm really looking forward to seeing what the next order of magnitude difference is. I'm going to speculate that's when, if you're not using functional principles of purity, that it's all going to fall apart. But I haven't written anything that's 2 million lines long, so I couldn't say. But the important thing here is that the approach you take at different scales to a problem is different. And this is true in programming, it's true in a lot of other subjects. And that complexity per size, it does actually vary a little bit. Simple code, simple as we defined it a moment ago, of one concept, one thread, has linear complexity. So the more code you add, the more the more difficult it becomes, but at a linear rate. Heavily complexed code has geometric complexity. That means you add, in the first case, you add one line of code. You go from 1,000 to 1,001 lines of code. You've added with that 0.01, something like that, percent to your difficulty of dealing with it. If you have 1,000 lines of highly complexed code and you add one more line, that line could affect 12 different subsystems. And so you're adding 1 or 2% to your difficulty of maintenance for the same line of code because the code is more complexed. This is not, as I said, this is not limited to computer science. Think of democracy. Around a dozen people, maybe two dozen, consensus works. Just get a bunch of people around a table and talk about it and you come to a conclusion. That can work fine. It scales to that level. You get above, that scale, and consensus just becomes far too problematic. It's far too unstructured, and you can scale it to direct democracy, where you actually have a vote to decide things rather than consensus. But everyone gets a vote. And that can scale to a few hundred people, maybe 1,000. Do you remember the original democracies, like Athens and so on? Every citizen had a vote. Citizens were maybe 5% of the actual population, which made that work. But the actual voting population was a few hundred, maybe 1,000. It was basically military officers is all they had. Above that, and you start seeing republics. You start seeing elected officials who take over the governance responsibility and get replaced periodically and so on. And see this all around the world. Even if you're dealing with a dictatorship, you have a small chieftain, he controls everything. He's the boss, whatever. Get up to kingdom-sized system, then most large-scale kingdoms or dictatorships have some kind of nobility. The structure may differ, but they've got some kind of internal organization to delegate authority. If you get up to worldwide empires, you've got some kind of local governor, maybe locally appointed, maybe appointed by the emperor, but you have some kind of internal structure that dictatorial emperor is not responsible for everything that's going on. They delegate authority. Different scale, different governmental styles, just like in code. The approach you take at one scale in anything is different than the approach you take at a different scale because the approaches don't scale up or down. Having an elected, elected republic for 12 people is just way too over-engineered. For 12 million people is a necessity. It works if no one does anything stupid is a terrible way of running anything. Thank you, Sam. So let's talk about structure. And let's go to Jo Freeman, a speech. She's a prominent feminist writer and activist. And this is a speech she gave at the Southern Female Rights Union in May of 1970 called The Tyranny of Structurelessness, talking about radical feminist movements in the United States at that time. And in the past 10 or 15 years at that point, many of which prided themselves on being unstructured organizations, on not having leaders, on not having hierarchies. And the point that she was making, which in my experience is completely true, is that you can't actually decide to have a structureless group, only whether or not to have a formally structured group. Human interaction creates structure. The fact that you have more than two people working together or doing something together, interacting together, means structure will happen. Informal structure will emerge on its own. You will not have an unstructured group. that structure is inevitable. Now, that doesn't mean the informal structure is inherently bad. If, you know, the group is a local user group, and, you know, your goal is to get together and share knowledge, then cool, informal structure is going to work great. If it's, you know, an awareness-raising group, and your goal is to get together and share experiences, either as women or as alcoholics or as, you know, whatever, if your goal is just peer communication, then an unstructured group works fine. But it doesn't necessarily scale. Formal structure is documented. You can look up what the structure is. You can ask someone and there's a definitive answer. It has clear change points. Who is responsible for X? It's written down, and there's a clear mechanism to know when the person responsible for X has changed. It could be as simple, as we defined it before, structure, or complex. Formal structure does not inherently mean fill things out in triplicate with five different offices. That's a complex structure. But formal structure doesn't have to be that. Formal structure could be as simple as that's the person who's responsible for, you know, cleaning up the chairs at the end of the day. That's their job, and they've got a name tag and everything. Can be very simple. And it leads to process. It leads to writing down rules. It leads to guidance and, you know, structure that you can reference, that you can look at, that you can put different people into. Informal structure, on the other hand, is very implicit. You learn it by becoming part of it, sort of. But everyone may have their own take on it and may have a different opinion about what it actually is. And when it changes, you don't necessarily know, or different people find out at different times in different ways. And again, it could be a very simple informal structure or a very complicated and complex formal structure. But what this leads to is elitism, at least it clicks. And when I say elitism here, I'm saying elitism the same way that Joe Freeman did. It's not a conspiracy. It's not people, you know, not a cabal getting together and deciding to take over the government or anything like that. It's people who have some common attribute, some common interest, who are participating in a group, work together better, so they form a clique, they form a party, they form a faction. And when that happens, you know, that group tends to take over because their communication channels are simpler. And that could be formed by, you know, people who have been friends and are friends outside of whatever this group is. It could be they went to the same school, so they, you know the same teachers, they were in the same fraternity. It could be they all work for the same company. It could be they're all men, they're all women. Some common element that is not relevant to the organization, to the group, but that becomes a structure around, an attribute around which informal structures will form and elites will form. Again, this is not necessarily a bad thing. People being friends is not a bad thing. It's bad if you are governed by this kind of elitism, because elites are informal structure. Informal structures fill in a vacuum in formal structure. If you do not have formal structure, informal structure will emerge to fill it. It will happen based on whatever. And informal structures may create informal qualifications. To be part of the leadership, you must be of the right age range. You must dress properly. You must dress improperly in the proper way. You must come from the right socioeconomic background. You must be of the right gender. You must be of the right race. You must know what the Drupal way is. These are all things that are inherently irrelevant to the group, but around which these informal structures will form if there's a vacuum to fill. Informal structure complexes structure of an organization with things that should be irrelevant. If you can have successful informal structures, and this is from Joe Freeman's article. To have a successful informal structure, informally structured group, the group must be task-oriented. There's a thing that they need to accomplish that is very clear and obvious. That task is just readily apparent to everyone. The group needs to be small and relatively homogeneous, which means that communication channels become really, really easy. It's really easy for the people to coordinate. There's very few communication channels, so information and knowledge can disseminate very, very fast. And low specialization. Good example here, organizing a Drupal camp. Not a DrupalCon, a Drupal camp. You need 5 to 10 people to organize it, and the person responsible for calling the venue to make sure that they have enough chairs, that's an unskilled job. That doesn't require special training to do. Anyone can do that, so anyone can do that. And so you have an informal structure that says, you know, Bob is responsible for calling the venue and making sure there's enough chairs, and you know, Jane is responsible for sorting out speakers. And all right, that works, whatever, we'll roll with it. And that can work out very well. Most Drupal camps work on that kind of informal structure, and that's okay. The problem, though, is when you get to questions like, who's actually in charge? If there is, in fact, a dispute that needs to get resolved, who's in charge? Who actually gets to make a decision if there is a problem? Who is responsible for something? Do we know, is Bob actually responsible for chairs? Who's doing chairs? Do we have that written down somewhere? Who's actually calling the speakers? Do we know? Who can veto? Who actually has the job of deciding, yes, the speaker is coming, yes, the speaker is not? Yes, we want this this keynote. No, we're not going to go to this venue because, you know, that venue hates us or whatever. Who has the authority to say yes or no in cases where you need to say yes or no? What back channels are there? There's always back channels. There is always back channels when you have more than two people communicating. What are they? Are they public? Should they be public? Do we know that they're there and they're not public, but we're okay with that? It's okay to have back channels that are not public as long as you know that they exist. But if you don't even know they exist, then you are inherently on the outside of that elite group. How do you get into the elite group? By, you know, whatever definition that is, the people in charge informally, how does one become one of the people who are in charge informally? When does one stop being one of the people who are in charge informally? Retire versus fired. People are starting to catch on here. You know, how do you step down from a position of leadership you never stepped up into? How are you fired from a position you were never hired for? How do you know when the person in charge is different? If a new person is running things now, for some definition of things, how does everyone else know who is not the five people at lunch who decided that this person is in charge now? How does anyone else know that? These are the problems with informal organizations and informal structure. I love this quote. If a movement continues to deliberately not select who exercises power, it does not mean that you eliminate power. All it does is abdicate the right to demand that those who exercise power be responsible with it. I'll say that again. All it does is abdicate the right to demand that those who exercise power are responsible with it. And if you keep power as diffuse as possible, because you can't demand responsibility, because you don't want to demand responsibility, it ensures that the movement is as ineffective as possible. Diffuse power is a very, very inefficient way of organizing power. Maybe you want that. The US government was set up to be very diffuse and slow as a defense mechanism to try and keep it from going off the rails. It happened anyway, but that's another story. But you can deliberately design inefficiency into a system by diffusing power. But that's only if that's what you want. This applies to any group. Point being, there is no such thing as structurelessness. Informal structure will happen, and if left to its own accord, will be complex and inefficient. It's simply the nature of human beings. It's another prominent feminist, Ash Dryden. I know a lot of people here probably met her at some point. This is an article she posted last year called The Ethics of Unpaid Labor in Open Source Development, talking about the problem with this idea of meritocracy. Meritocracy, as she defined it and pulled from Wikipedia for it, is the belief that those with merit, for some definition of merit, float to the top and are given more opportunities, paid higher, more access, you know, whatever the opportunities are. Problem with that. Merit doesn't exist on its own. It would be lovely in a wonderful world if those most able to handle a problem are the ones who get to handle it and get benefits commensurate with that. I would love to live in that world. Unfortunately, merit doesn't exist on its own. You may have qualifications for something, to volunteer for something, but if you have kids or a family that you're taking care of, you have a sick relative at home you're caring for, you have a child who has higher medical needs than someone else's child, that inhibits your ability to do something for reasons that have nothing to do with your skill at the thing in question. You know, maybe it's you're driving. I have to spend more time at home taking care of a sick kid who has cancer, therefore I don't have as much time to drive. So I can't be rewarded more for driving. So I don't get the rewards, despite the fact I'm the best driver around. You could have your own medical conditions that, you know, limit your ability to do whatever. You may have a long commute. You don't have as much volunteer time. You know, my commute to work in the morning is a half hour or so each way. So that's an hour out of my day that I can't volunteer for anything. Someone else works from home. That's an extra hour they have to do, to volunteer on something that I don't. Someone else has a two-hour commute. That means, you know, they've got 4 hours out of their day that they cannot donate to anything. You could have an employment contract that says you're not allowed to contribute to open source. You may have an employment contract that says we own copyright on anything you do, even outside of work hours. Lots of people do, especially in the U.S. It's disgusting, but they do. The problem here, unequal opportunity, the problem with meritocracy is that it conflicts merit and opportunity. And these could be unequal. You know, Asher's article talks mainly about racial and gender differences in opportunity, but it applies, you know, applies to those. It applies to anything else as well. Anytime there's an unequal opportunity, it means meritocracy doesn't work right. And we all have unequal opportunity on everything for a variety of reasons. Now, in Drupal, we don't call things meritocracy. We use a different word, duocracy, which roughly translates as 1 hour, one vote. You want something, you do it. You don't have time to do it? Sorry. What does this actually mean? What does duocracy actually imply? Rule by those with nothing better to do with their time. I'm not actually the first one to say this. There are people saying this after the Drupal 7 cycle, too. This is what duocracy means in practice. It means rule by those who have lots of spare time to do. People who don't have as much spare time, for whatever reason, are inherently at a disadvantage, regardless of their actual ability to do whatever it is that you're doing. So how does this apply to Drupal? Someone's giggling. Okay. Let me ask you this simple question. Who is Drupal's technical lead? Who is Drupal's lead architect? My life would be so much simpler.
Drupal wouldn't.
We'll get to that later. So, yeah, I'm an initiative lead. What does an initiative lead do? What does being an initiative lead actually mean?
Not in the goddamn
thing. I got another initiative lead.
People can blame you.
It means people can blame you, uh-huh.
For decisions you did not make.
This is what is actually listed on our website for what initiative lead means. It means we coordinate and communicate. Initiative leads are glorified secretaries. The only job description I have as web services initiative lead is glorified secretary. Note what's missing from here. Any sense of authority or power. As initiative lead, I do not have any actual formal power at all. That's true of every initiative lead. How about component maintainers? We've got 20 or so of them listed in maintainers.txt.
70.
70? All right, we've got a lot of them listed in maintainers.txt. What do they do? According to the website, they do issue queue farming, mentoring, they're the person you can harass about something, they review patches, answer questions, and write issues for other people to do. They're glorified secretaries. Note, nothing here about authority or deciding future of a module or a subsystem. This is what's actually on the website. This is the closest we have to a formal structure is this. Who here is mentioned in maintainers.txt somewhere? In writing, the only formal structure we have is you are a secretary.
That's not what that says.
How about branch maintainers? Do we have branch maintainers in here? I thought we had one. This is what it says on the website. Oversee the developments of a major version by making ultimate decisions on which patches are applied to the software and working with the community to set goals, priorities, and guidelines. So we actually have someone here who has, you know, the word decision. So we've got, what is it, four people who have the word decision on their job description?
For Drupal 8.
For Drupal 8, yeah. So, you know, the branch maintainer, then this, for Drupal 8, it's catch. With, I don't know if Alex is technically a branch maintainer or just a committer. What's that?
It's probably a
release manager. Yeah. Is Catch's official
okay.
title.
Okay. So yeah, you know, Catch actually has ultimate decision-making power on a patch-by-patch basis, except when Dries is the one who has that authority. And as someone who's in the issue queue on a regular basis, I only know one guideline by which to say Dries gets responsibility for something, and that's when we're adding a new third-party library. Other than that, I don't actually know what the policy is on when you assign something to one core maintainer or another. I don't know that anyone does except them.
Informal structure.
How big is Core now? And we've got four people who are responsible for knowing enough of it to set direction for the entire thing as one big, gigantic project, down to the level of individual lines of code. So who is Drupal's technical lead? Remember, we're a duocracy. This question was asked on Twitter, and this was the answer. Harsh but true.
Which is funny, because that's probably Daniel.
It's either Daniel or Tim, depending on the week.
I would disagree, actually.
So that's our tech lead. Who used to be the tech lead? We don't know when a tech lead changes, not even the person who is an informal de facto tech lead. What does it feel like to get edged out of that kind of position of authority informally without ever being told? I haven't experienced it yet, but I'm pretty sure it sucks for everybody. New contributors, you know, ask this question. Who do I need to run this issue by? Who do I need to get sign off from for this patch or that patch or this recommendation or whatever? I couldn't actually tell you. The reviewer. So random other newbie who comes by the issue. Maybe. Depends on the issue. Some issues, yes. Some issues, you need to run it by someone else. Is this an issue that you need to run by Tim Plunkett? I don't know. Is this an issue you need to run by Daniel? Well, I might know because I happen to know these things because I've been working with Daniel for the last year and a half. But that's only because I've been working with Daniel for the last year and a half. Oh, no, this thing, you probably want to talk to Wim on that one. Or, no, this one, oh, you should probably go ask Kat Bailey because she hasn't been around for a year, but she still worked on that part, so she knows what's going on. If you haven't had your hands deep inside the system for the past 3 years, how do you know any of this? You don't. Not selecting who exercises power does not abolish power. It simply abdicates the right to demand that those who exercise power are responsible with it. We ignore component maintainers on a daily basis. Fact. Couple of examples. Just this week, I noticed, actually, Daniel pointed out to me, a patch went into the database layer that had a static call against the Unicode utility library, which means we have now complected our database layer to our Unicode library with a static method call. As database maintainer, I would never have approved that, but no one asked. I'm the maintainer for the routing system. 6 months ago, another core contributor changed part of the API around route handling that I'd written as part of a series of patches to go in a certain direction. And he changed it, and I didn't find out about it until 2 days after it was committed. 6 months later, we haven't undone that damage yet, because I spent the first 5 months of it trying to argue that point, that this piece of this subsystem that I am the maintainer for and the primary author, yes, should be this way, stop arguing with me. And it's not just me. I'm not just complaining that I don't get my way. I've done this to other people too. And who here knows Khaled Behilin? He was in one of the videos at the pre-note. He's the subsystem maintainer for the DB log module and the syslog module. except we have gutted and rewritten both of those. Paris Liakos and I gutted and rewrote the entire logging system to use PSR3. I don't think Khaled even knows it yet. We didn't actually ask him. We just did it. And it got committed. I'm not sure if he even knows that it's happened yet. This is a regular daily occurrence. 1 hour, one vote. If you know, being a branch maintainer or being a subsystem maintainer doesn't actually count. So why is Drupal 8 not done? Why is why was certain part of some initiative not completed? Well, Angie asked this question on Twitter a couple of days ago. But like, was it 2 weeks ago now? 3 weeks, something like that. And I highly recommend reading the full thread. There's a link here and a link from the session page. But I want to call out a few of the responses. I have no desire to spend time attempting to disagree with someone who likes sleep less than me. Because the person who likes sleep less is going to win the battle. My mental health is worth more to me than Tor's release date. This is Greg Dunlap, who was our first initiative lead and stepped down from the position after 2 years. Anyone remember Jacine Luisi? She was the initiative lead for the HTML5 initiative. She burned out badly within the first year because that was the most bike-shuttable discussion we could possibly have, is what markup do we use when moving things over to HTML5, and she got slammed by everyone who had more time than skill arguing about every little detail. She never had the authority as initiative lead to say, no, we're doing X. We're going this way with it. Stop talking. And so it destroyed her. She quit the project. How many core developers have been a major significant mover and shaker for 3 or more core releases? Can anyone name them? I can name 2. Chex and Stephen Wittens. In Drupal's, what is it, 15-year history? No. 14-year history? 2. That should tell us something. Remember, we're a duocracy, ruled by those with nothing better to do with their time. That's a constantly shifting population as people burn out, because we have decision-making by attrition. Easy also means easily replaceable. If something is easily recognizable to a large population, it's really easy to find a replacement. If you burn out a volunteer, there's another volunteer just waiting who would love to help out and take the place of the person you just burned out. We have a huge burnout problem in core development. This is not a new statement. It's been said for easily 6 years. But we keep churning along because there's always another volunteer to take their place. Is that actually how we should be running core? Our result, no one actually has authority in Drupal. Everything, this structure begs for bike sheds. We have bike shed discussions in issue queue daily because our structure demands it. Which means that the steamroller developers, and I say this as someone who is one, they win by doing things the easy way. And in this case, I mean, this gets a patch in that everyone can understand the feature at the end of it. The code inside it may be horribly complicated, but it looks easy. It looks obvious. I understand this one patch, and so good enough. Except easy is not simple. Easy papers over complexity, but it is not simple. So we get lots and lots of code that is not simple. It may be easy, but that's just building up complexity. It's building up complexity. Informality at the scale that Drupal is horribly complex. We have nearly twice as many contributors to Drupal 8 as the Linux kernel had to version 3.10. We are huge. Informality does not scale to this level. So who has authority? It's not the initiative leads, it's not maintainers, it's not component maintainers. There isn't any. Drupal, the code base, remember we said before, you inherit the complexity of everything below you. You cannot avoid inheriting the complexity of everything below you. Drupal, the code base, inherits all of the complexity of the Drupal community. All of the inherent complexity in the Drupal community and development process impacts our code. Drupal core is complex because Drupal, the community, is complex. And this is not something new that I'm saying. This is Conway's Law from 1968, which Harvard researchers have verified before. Organizations which design systems are constrained to produce designs which are copies of the communication structures of those organizations. Who's had the problem where you've had to explain to a client, no, your organizational chart is not the right way to design the IA on your website? You know, we've all had that experience. This is the exact same problem at work. The only way to manage complexity is to eliminate it. And I mean eliminate it in the code and in the community at the same time. We complex too much. The way to do that is clear, decoupled structure. We need clear, decoupled structure in the code and in the community. We are too complexed with each other, and so our code is too complexed with itself. Now, let's be fair. Drupal 8 has improved the situation. A ton of work has gone into improving that tight coupling. Drupal 8 is more decoupled than any version of Drupal before it, by a wide margin. And yet we still are throwing static calls through random other classes in the middle of code somewhere without talking to anyone because it's easy to do. Two steps forward, one step back. We still have a long way to go. How do we do that? This is not a framework versus application discussion. I'm not talking about splitting framework and application from each other or anything like that. Joomla actually tried that at one point. They split the Joomla project into Joomla framework and Joomla the CMS, and they don't actually talk to each other anymore. So let's not do that. Let's learn from that. Let's learn instead from some of the other large open source projects. These projects, these nine projects, are, as of 2010, 10 times larger in terms of number of participants than any other open source project. We're in a pretty high level here. Drupal is among the elite of open source projects. To be fair, this is a really nice group of friends to keep. So let's look at some of them. I actually tried to reach out to some of these projects and their initiative leads, or their representatives, and they were all too busy to talk. So, but there are some commonalities that we do know about these projects. One is that they're all community projects. There are lots of successful open source projects that are backed by one company. MySQL, MongoDB, various others. But these big projects are not. They all have some kind of nonprofit foundation at their core. This includes us. In our case, it would be the Drupal Association. And they are all architecturally highly modular, or they are collections of software that come from different places. The emphasis is on this modularity. That is how you are able to scale, is divide and conquer. It's break things up into distinct components. So as I said, I tried to reach out to some of these and didn't get much response. So we'll go with what we do know, which is public knowledge. From Linux. Again, a project half our size. Linus Torvalds does not merge patches. He just doesn't do it. He doesn't deal with individual commits. There are component maintainers for different parts of the kernel or different drivers. They merge stuff. If you have a patch or a bug fix to the SCSI subsystem, you don't talk to Linus, you talk to the maintainer of that subsystem. Linus doesn't enter the picture until a month later, that subsystem maintainer sends a large change set all up to Linus at once, and he merges that whole branch with contributions from 20 different people doing all kinds of different things. And he'll look it over, but he'll trust that subsystem maintainer knows what he's doing. And this works because most components in Linux are, in fact, fairly well decomplected. 2/3 of it is drivers, and those are fairly standalone. As long as the API to the kernel itself doesn't change, do what you want, you're not going to break anyone else. You may break the driver for this one little piece of hardware, but you're not going to break the system. The core system, Linus will take, will watch it more, but there's still a lot of work to try and keep things separate from each other. Drupal needs to be a composition of different components. Right now, we are a complexion of components. Our different subsystems are still too tightly coupled because we are too tightly coupled. Both our code and community need to be a composition, not a complexion. Contrib sort of has this, because you know you can mix and match those, and those are independent of each other. Unless you have an explicit dependency, you're not going to break someone else. But core, getting bigger and bigger and bigger, is less and less like this. Core needs that kind of benefit that Contrib actually has. My recommendation for this is not a new one. Subsystem maintainers need to have actual authority over their subsystems. They need to be able to say no. They need to be able to say yes and have it stick. Give them responsibility and authority. And someone's going to ask, well, how do we, you know, make changes that cross everything? Are we going to have to get sign-off from 20 different subsystem maintainers? The fact that you're making a change that seems simple but needs to sign off from 20 different subsystem maintainers is the bug. Make complexing painful. That forces us to decouple. That forces decomplexion. That forces us to break things apart because we have to. Right now, everything is in one big pool because that's how we're structured. If we instead have a series of connected pools, we'll have a series of connected components. This is, you know, forcing the issue. The fact that we need to talk to a dozen different systems to make a change is the problem. Yes, there is some pain in this. There's going to be pain in the new release cycle, too, where we look at it and go, hey, I want to make this change for 8.1 or 8.2, but I can't because that's an API change, but I can make this change over here because that was more loosely coupled. That development process in Drupal 8 is going to mean pain for the core developers as they realize, oh, this decoupling and simple thing actually matters. I'm going to experience it myself and actually get a respect for it. It's going to be an educational process for us. Exact same thing here. We need to force ourselves to see the problem and force ourselves to solve the problem. Another recent post from Sam called Keeping It Simple, where he talks about many of these same concepts. He has some recommendations as well. These are all open for discussion. He sees
what? We are, yes.
A simplifier role. It is like the words he used. This is a person who is a keeper of simplicity and quality in a focused area. Possibly same as subsystem maintainer, possibly not. But they are not interested in release dates or global strategy. They are interested in the forum module. They're interested in this module being good, this module being simple, this module not being tied up in 12 other things unless there's a very good reason for it to be. They're not interested in functionality. They're not interested in things that will sell to VPs. They're interested in code quality. They're interested in being responsible for the upkeep of this system, responsible and authority. Responsibility and authority must always come together as a pair. They can partner with the easy people. And by easy people, I mean people who are interested in making things easy. You know, if we've got, we were talking, I think it was earlier today or yesterday, about they need to get designers more involved in the process. If every module, every subsystem had a person who was responsible for the code, authority and responsibility, and they're not they don't deal with UI. They deal with code being good. And they partner with someone who can talk about UI and make it easy. So you have someone guarding easy and someone guarding simple, and they work together. Then you've got a path to a clean, good, powerful system. We need to have a brutal, and I mean brutal, focus on simplicity. I'd say starting as soon as we hit 8.0.0. At all levels, code, UI, and community. A heavy focus on simplifying, on decomplexing. Not on making things easier to do, but on making things easier to understand. Making things less tied together in weird and undocumented ways. And if that means along the way we lose some easy or lose some features, that's necessary. You can build easy on top of simple. You cannot build simple on top of easy. We need to focus on simple so that we can build the next generation of easy. Thank you. I now don my flame retardant suit. There's a microphone in the middle of the room.
I think this distributed power of a different subsystems, it works if there's competition and the possibility to drop one solution and use another one instead. So that at the top there's someone who just puts different stuff together and composes it, like you said, and then one person may have the power over one subsystem, but if the power of otherwise means that you also have the power to do like the wrong thing or something that others don't like, and then the others have the option to opt out of this thing and use a different solution or a fork or something. And in Drupal, we have everything in the same repository. So if one subsystem maintainer sucks or doesn't care about the project, it goes in a different direction.
Then they need to be replaced by trees.
Okay.
But then we have an explicit statement of this person has been replaced with this person. Uh-oh.
Hi, Larry. Oh,
so for the recording, this is Jess, XJM.
My name is Jess. I'm XJM on Drupal.org. For context, my full-time job is doing release management for Drupal 8. So first of all, I need to call you out on something. I'm going to read to you the actual language from the component maintainers page on Drupal.org. It says, monitoring the issue subsystem queue, also known as issue farming, when a new issue is submitted that involves verifying that it's a valid issue, taking appropriate action, tag as novice, change the status, if more information is needed, if it's not really a bug, change issue parameters, etc. That sounds like secretary work, sure. Mentoring new contributors who are working on issues related to that subsystem, being the point of contact for that subsystem's contributors, reviewing proposed patches on that subsystem, acting as an expert on the workings of that system, answering questions that come up, and being involved in discussions of major overhauls and re-architecting, and translating strategic thinking about their subsystem into actual issues. So I think what you put on the slide was misleading, first of all, and I also think it's extremely, I will say, not strategic to call that a glorified secretary because there's extremely valuable skills in there. Am I a secretary, Larry? Is Kathy Faze a secretary? Being dismissive of those roles and the contribution and the technical expertise that is required to perform those roles, I think, is a bad idea. So that's all. Just wanted to point that out.
My point is, it's responsibility without authority. What's in writing is responsibility without authority.
Glorified secretary is not what it is. But then I did have two actual comments on the content of your presentation that I wanted to ask about. So the one thing that you said that's come up a lot of times before is, well, I will just say that having every subsystem maintainer be responsible for their subsystem, be the final authority and control that part of it, sounds on paper like that seems like a fabulous idea. You know, every time people bring it up. When I went to DrupalCon Denver and I heard a core conversation present I think it was maybe Greg's core conversation presented that day, it sounds fabulous. Until you actually have to work with all the component maintainers all of the time and you see the varying levels of... And another thing that plays into that is, I believe, Sam's blog post. He said something in there about like not having a concern about the overall release date of the project as part of the thing that... And, well, that doesn't... like if so, you, people ask why Drupal 8 is not out yet. That's a big part, is that there are a lot of people who have... technical roles in the project who don't care when Drupal 8 comes out, and that's part of why it's taking so long. And so if there is, and I think I've heard a lot of people say that that's a serious risk, that they have clients or their own shop are considering moving to a different solution because of how long Drupal 8 has taken to get to even a beta, I mean, it's okay for an individual person to say, you know, I don't care about the release cycle, that's not relevant to me, but I don't think that we can put them in charge of Drupal's code base.
I think it's a different role. It's not that there should be no one, you know, who's concerned about release date. And I don't think what Sam was describing necessarily maps to subsystem maintainer in all cases. But someone, you know, there needs to be someone whose primary focus is keeping the code base simple, keeping the quality up, separate from what features can we check off. Those are different roles. And we don't have anyone who is empowered to focus on keep things simple. We just keep making things more complex.
I would say that it's an overgeneralization and you're assigning motivations to other contributors that aren't necessarily there.
I don't think you're assigning motivations to contributors at all. The motivation is to get crap.
Microphone.
No.
But the thing is that it doesn't get crap done. That's the thing. If you're concerned about
no,
the fact
I'm
that...
saying,
as opposed to simple. Mm-hmm. I can agree with that.
Yeah.
But
and I don't exclude myself from that in the slightest.
So then the one question I do have is if we want so you described a system when a situation where a commit was made to the database component mm-hmm. that added an unnecessary coupling or an undesirable mm-hmm. coupling, and no one asked you about it. And so the question that floated across my mind then was, well, your answer will be, well, I should just be able to commit to the database component, presumably. But the question is,
maybe not this, necessarily.
In you don't have the availability though, to every single time that there's a data. How much longer will it take to get a patch? And if every single time there's a patch that needs to be into the data subsystem, it has to go through you instead of the core maintainers who have this between the four of them this extreme concentration of time available.
Which ties into the resourcing questions and funding questions that have been happening all week. These subsystem maintainers, if we're going to make them local authorities, need the resourcing to be local authorities. We also need to then defer to them when appropriate. And right now we don't do either one of those, and that's a problem.
Part of your point was the complexity of Drupal maps to the complexity of the community. Mm-hmm. Your proposals address how we handle really leadership in the community, and I'm wondering what the impact of those kinds of changes would have on the overall community, because the community's the whole point of this was the complexity of the community, mm-hmm. and the leadership is just one small piece of that.
And I see it as building a clear and documented skeleton around which the organic community can still work. I'm not saying we should get rid of organic contributors and drive-by contributors. Those are great. We're twice the size of Linux. That's awesome. But there needs to be, a skeleton that they can latch onto. Who is in charge of X? I want to work on this kind of thing. Where's the page that tells me who I should talk to see what the current roadmap for that section is? I don't have an answer for that question if someone says, if someone comes into the IRC channel and says, I want to help with Drupal, I kind of am interested in this kind of thing. I know personally who to send them to most of the time, but that's because I'm in IRC far more than it's healthy. For someone who is not, or for someone who doesn't know to hop into IRC, how do you find out? Maintainers.txt is not actually accurate in terms of that answer.
I was just going to point out that the other thing with being a maintainer and actually maintaining that code base is that we're kind of disincentivized around it right now. Mm-hmm. So, as someone who's in maintainers.txt, it's my job to actually know and facilitate the commits or whatever mm-hmm. of new patches to the plugin system. It's great. I don't check that list, though, because a lot of times it doesn't really matter what I say there. So despite the fact that I actually do understand how that's going to have an effect on the component mm-hmm. in question, it's largely just me saying, hey, you shouldn't do this mm-hmm. because, and then getting to undo it at some later date when people run into bugs because they did what I told them not to do, right? And, this has happened time and again, not just with that, but, there is a system in place that actively disincentivizes people who are in charge in many situations.
Responsibility without authority. Yeah. I think we have time for one more comment if anyone else wants to disagree with me. Okay.
I've encountered the kind of power vacuum that you're talking about in all kinds of different contexts outside of web development. So you might have heard of Byron Bay in Australia. Famous alternative kind of area, probably a bit like San Francisco in the States, although I've never been there. But the thing is, when you get a large group of people who all kind of, are simpatico in some way, but and they have some kind of alignment, but they don't have a power structure to sort of keep that in place, then, things fall apart over time. Mm-hmm. And it's really sad. You see it in so many different contexts, in companies and organizations and whole geographic communities. So I really get what you're saying with this talk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and there's... I cited a whole bunch of sources here. If I looked another 2 hours, I could find a dozen more that observe this process elsewhere of trying to be informal and structurelessness and it coming back to bite you. So this is not by in any way, shape, or form a Drupal unique problem. And just like the funding problem, we need to be looking elsewhere and see how has this been solved, how does this work, what has not worked. And the model I'm looking at is Linux. I'm open to other models, but the current model is not scaling.
I just want to say, from what I've heard, it sounds, I mean, I'm not a core maintainer, so sorry I'm here. But from what I've heard you say, it sounds eminently sensible. So my question is, what's the next step? What are you asking people to do?
We have to convince the structuralist structure that Larry's right.
So for the recording, Chris just commented we have to just convince the structuralist structure that Larry's right or has a point. I think keep this conversation going. Think about what kinds of structure do we want. We have a structure now. I would submit it's not a good structure. What structure do we want instead? Let's look at other organizations. Let's see, if anyone knows someone who works on Mozilla, on Firefox, or knows someone who works on KDE, or knows someone who works on GNOME, talk to them. Get information from them. See what they've done with this kind of problem. And blog about it. Let us know. I would love to know.
There's a project that shall not be named that has adopted the governance model very publicly of the Apache organization. And while I might not agree with them on their technical aims, their governance model, at least that they're emulating, that's been documented both at apache.org and at certain unnamed project site, as something probably, there's something we could probably take away from that as well.
Potentially. Yeah, and I do think I know which project you're talking about.
Yes. Oh, no, absolutely.
Yes.
I agree.
Make change, I mean, in general. Mm-hmm.
We'll have some Apache folks at that camp if you want to talk to them.
Okay. Yeah. But yeah, that's, I think, next step is.
That if he submits this talk to bad camp.
Oh, can you repeat what David said?
David Wang was saying, there are a project that we know, but will not name, that has adopted an Apache-style governance model that we could look at and see how it works there and potentially learn from that, too. Is that an accurate summary?
Yeah.
Okay.
And mostly due to the fact that it works for Apache, not that, it's gangbusters for
sure. And it's also possible that some of these other organizations haven't quite figured it out and have just the same problem or some related problem. Let's find out. Let's get off our governance island, too, as long as we're at it, and figure out where we want to move to and do so deliberately. And with that, I think we're done. Enjoy the rest of the conference. And despite anything I said here, I expect to see all of you at the sprint on Friday, because we do still have a release to get out.